not guilty, not guilty.
The whole world saw this videotape. The whole world saw Rodney King beaten to a bloody pulp.
The Midtown Shopping Plaza is on fire. There are no police officers here. There are no fire units on the scene. This thing has been burning completely untouched for about the last 20 minutes.
Great tranquil Pacific Ocean. Gentle breezes coming in from the west. As we look across to the east, what I'm reminded most of is a picture of Kuwait late in the war. Column after column after column of black smoke towering thousands of feet in the air.
My name's Bob Turr. You may not know who I am, but you're sure aware of the videotape that I shot here at this intersection of Florence and Normandy, back at the very flashpoint of the Los Angeles riots. I was here at the scene, 100 feet up in the air in a news helicopter, shooting dramatic, graphic pictures of the very first violence associated with the LA riots. Oh, look at that. Terrible. And there's no police presence down here. They will not enter the area. That's right. This is attempted murder. For several hours, we hovered over the intersection. Across the street is Tom's Liquor Store. That place was the first store to be looted in the city of Los Angeles. Minutes later, actual rioting and beatings began. Here at this gas station, right over here, this area was looted minutes later. People taking stuff out from the cash register, breaking down the pumps, and also firing shotguns trying to cause an explosion. Newscopter 13 has been fired upon by people with guns down below. We've seen the muzzle flash and smoke. What we have down here, folks, is a lot of angry people rioting in the street. There's a live picture. This became ground zero for the start of the LA riots.
It's April 29th, 1992, and some crazy shit is going on. Let me tell you, me and Mark, you could say we all so-called tripping, whatever, but we angry. I can tell you that.
When I seen the people protesting, I said, well, I need to go get my camera because this is a piece of history, you know, that need to be taped. And I thought instantly about a documentary, you know.
Look at that. Channel 9 News. Channel 9 News on the motherfucking black neighborhoods talking shit, trying to make us look bad, but they ain't doing nothing.
I'm sure everybody was in a different state of mind at the time because I was. I never felt like that before. And if I felt like that, I know they had to feel like that, or worse.
There you go. Yeah.
He said, there you go.
Yeah.
I went up and down Florence Avenue and on a corner of Normandy in Florence. And I just really kept my camera going most of the time. A man beat to the ground basically, and I walked up on that and he had a big hole in his head from a speaker being thrown at him or something, and he was like passed out, and some people around him, they started spray painting him black and saying, you know, you're black now, you're black now. People ask me, you know, well, why didn't you help this man out? He had at least 8 people around him. Now, what could I do? You know what I'm saying? I would have been on that ground too. I basically just stayed out of the way. What I wanted to do and why I was over there was to document what was going on.
I remember the night that the riots broke out. It was kind of, it was a Wednesday night. As we pulled up to Carlos's house, I remember it was dark, and his daughter came, his daughter Mona, his older daughter, came running out. She said that the city was burning. You know, LA City was on fire, and people were fighting everywhere. And we kind of thought, yeah, right. We went in, and gosh, I just couldn't believe what I saw on the TV. She was right. The city of LA was burning. So as we're approaching the city, we're coming into Los Angeles, we start to smell the smoke. You can see the fires. And I started to worry then. I started to get a bit concerned about my children. And I remember asking him, I said, if we don't know what's going to happen during this time. If anything happens to me, you know, promise me you'll take care of the kids.
We got called out that next morning, thinking that it was all over. And we went right into a hornet's nest. It's something I never would have imagined happening in my lifetime. Maybe in one of those movies, those futuristic movies, Mad Max, that's what kind of, just to watch these hordes of people just running through the streets with TVs, VCRs. We even watch a couple of people roll up in taxi cabs, and the taxi driver kept the meter running while they went in and grabbed some TVs and VCRs.
On that corner is where my father tried to hold down the, I guess, face down the crowd. And at that corner, also, my mother was shot as they were trying to leave the location. We were under gunfire when we arrived to the location. Our van sustained bullet holes, and people were throwing Molotov cocktails into the store. And at that point, we no longer felt that we can defend the place. So we tried to leave. And when we saw patrol cars outside, we thought this is our chance to leave. And we thought they were there to help us. But to our surprise, they proceeded to arrest us. I've never been in war, nor have I ever had people point their guns and shoot at me, nor have I had the opportunity to point the guns and shoot at other people. However, having been through that, I felt like I'd been through a war. Our losses were in excess of $2.2 million, including the building and the inventory. We're not even accounting for the economic damage that we've suffered. I think it'll be a show of defeat if we do not rebuild. We've taken a licking, however, you can't keep us down.
The next morning, we were packed and ready to leave, and I had a speaking engagement that I was speaking 1st of May at, and we had to fly over to Hawaii. We were in the car, and we were actually listening to the news and trying to figure how to drive to get to the airport, because the airport was getting ready to close down. And we could see barricades in the roads and streets as we were cutting across our way to try to find a way. My husband said we should try to make it if we could because it was so chaotic. He was very scared for us. He thought that if we left, we would be safer, actually. He actually thought that. We got to the airport, and the airport was still open. Within about 2 hours when our plane left, the airport closed. We flew over, and in 5 hours, when we arrived, the first thing we did was obviously turn on the TV. And what happened to me was I was getting angry. I had no power. I was thousands away, miles away. I was safe. I was trying to say to the television, why are you guys doing this? Why are you not giving people any power? Why are you increasing the violence by what they were doing? And I realized the media was getting off on seeing people hurt. And that impacted on my decision to run for the mayor's race because I wanted to talk about women's and children's issues and I wanted to be part of the process. Now, even if I wouldn't win or couldn't get my voice out there, even if I'd be censored, even if I'd be blacklisted.
I will tell the story of the day that Rodney King, the verdict came. I was at school. And everybody in the office as we were leaving school was like, did you hear, did you hear, did you hear? And everybody was saying what the verdict was. And at that point, nobody knew what the impact of it was gonna be. And a lot of times last year or the previous years, I would make a decision about driving home. Oftentimes, usually I drive home on the freeway, but a lot of times I was getting really tired of having to be on the freeway every day. So I drive straight down Florence, which takes me right to the 405. And I made a decision as I came up to the freeway on ramp. I thought, oh, I want to get home quickly. I have to pick up Peter. I'll go on the freeway. And I did. And that day, and if I hadn't done, I probably would have been at the intersection of Florence and Normandy for all of the mayhem that was going on. This city amazes me. I think this corner epitomizes the heart of this city. It's an angry city. I think what happened at this intersection is people's anger was so intense, they didn't know what to do. Nobody knows what anybody else is about. Nobody bothers to stop and find out about these other cultures. You know, what does it mean to be from El Salvador? What does it mean to be a Black American living in Inglewood? What does it mean to be a refugee from Guatemala? What does it mean to be trying to raise your kids when you left your home in Mexico and your kids were born here, but you still have ties to your family back there? And that's what this city is about. It's about all these disparate cultures trying to come together, and they don't come together.
Put your hands in the air like this. Put your hands up and down. Come on. Put your hands in the air like this. Put your hands up and down. Come on. Put your hands in the air like this. Move your hands up and down. Come on, put your hands in the air like this. Move your hands up and down. Hey, yo, check this out.
Some people don't believe it's gonna work, but we got too many people here that are making it work. Programs opened up for jobs. Hey, next week, when I come back, I want to see everybody out here cleaning. I want to see walls, everybody cleaning with us when they clean. Everybody come out.
Yes, my name is Charles Rachel. I'm a gang member, alias Cubone, from the Crips gang in South Central Los Angeles. As you see, we have two main rival gangs, the Bloods and the Crips. After the riots, me and some friends decided it was time for the gangs to come together. And here, the Bloods and Crips are having together for the first time ever a party, dancing, as we sit there and set patterns for our future generation of leadership and quality, productive citizens.
The true thing needs to be said. And that's stay Black and stay too goddamn strong.
This is my childhood friend Leon, who's a Blood, who came together during the truce to form South Central Blackness, an organization to help the youth of South Central have a better future and a better place to live.
That's my hookup, Five Deuce. I hope you got it good. Five and a Deuce cousin. That was the Crip side right there. See? That's C-R-I-P and, you know, this that gang stuff, this stuff that really struck L.A. up, you know. I mean, it messed me up, man, but I feel good now. See, right here I have one. You know, I mean, kids, people of the world, leave the gang activity alone. Take it from a man that's there, still in there, but in there to help them out, in there to get them out of it. Just be there when I bring them out of there, so they won't have to go back into that. I beg of you, please. Praise God and peace.
Fuck that.
Fuck up. Hey, man. Hey, man. Hey, man.
My name is Ennis, and I hope I live through the end of 92 and 93, and I hope I make through these years now, because, you know, niggas killing little people because they didn't do nothing, and I hope I live to 25 or more. I hope I live, in, you know, until God say, until God say I gotta go right then.
Today I'm gonna show you my dad cleaners behind me, and hold on. Right there, that's my dad shop right there where it say LA discount.
Hey, Dad, say hi to the camera. Just wave.
Huh?
Just wave to the camera. I think in my way, I want to be work at a cleaner's, owner cleaner's, or be in a movie, or work at the movie.
This is my bed, and that's the telephone, that's the clock, and that's the bed, and you know, it's kind of dark right now, and that's my radio, and that's the TV.
Like how when I was a baby, I was a...
was the sweetest thing in the world. I sent up to the hospital, California hospital, to pick you and pad up. They dropped you all, brought you all by the cleaners. And I kept you down there to the cleaners until I closed. Then I took you home. And Pat was going to nurse you from her breath. I told her, nope. And putting them drugs on my baby. She fixed your formula, ate, give you a good bath, laid you out on the bed, on the towel, and boy, we just had a little party like. And from then on, there wasn't nobody but you and I.
What do you got in your hand?
My dad's card.
What do you mean?
It's for Los Angeles Times.
What's for what?
Los Angeles Times.
Let me see. What do you think about that?
It's cool.
How come?
I don't know.
I cover the Los Angeles Police Department, but in truth, for the last 2 years, I've written almost totally about the Rodney King incident. I covered the beating itself and the scandal that followed it. I covered the first trial of the officers, the not guilty verdicts, and the riots that followed. In the midst of the King incident, the Christopher Commission was impaneled to investigate the problems within the Los Angeles Police Department. As part of their report, they highlighted 44 police officers who they felt were the worst officers on the department. That list was kept secret, but I've recently obtained a copy of it, and now I'm preparing to write about these officers, to name them and to detail their misdeeds.
Can I tell you something, first
tell
of
them,
all?
So tell
Can
them
I tell you something? I was his editor.
He was my editor. Right
I was
here.
His
my
editor, editor right on the Rodney King case for right months.
Months. Months. Months, right here.
And, you know, on... I just want to say that, it took us 3 or 4 months to figure out that his name was Rodney King. Now, is it Rodney G. King, Rodney F. King, Rodney H. King?
After the lawsuit, it'll be Rodney whatever you want to be, King.
It's not educating students. It's not teaching them anything. It's teaching them to fail. What would you want to show people?
That we're not animals, not beasts. That, you know, we're not all bad people.
You never know when your time comes that you probably get killed by a loose bullet, you know? Never know.
You know, it's like, if you're running with that group and I'm running with this group, and you do something to my friend, we're gonna get you. I'm gonna get you.
That's it. We got it.
That we are all of different colors, and as long as our blood and our hearts are the same, we can all be the same no matter what. We'll do portfolio assessments next week. This will be the majority of your grade. What I have decided, though, is that your unit essay exam and your project, you will need to do them. What they will do is either keep your grade the same or raise it up. It will not bring you down unless you don't do them. If you did not do the unit essay exam, try to see me sometime today.
Kevin, escuchan. Yes.
Any other questions? Any other problems?
In American dollars.
Whoa. Worth nothing.
You will need to do your project presentations. If you didn't get a sheet about the project, there's a few left up here. Please make sure you're working on Monday in class. I will talk about it. The system is not set up to show what students can do. The system is constantly showing what students cannot do. And students are failing all over the place. They're failing in their exams. They're failing in their classes. They're failing by not coming to school. I don't think the education system is set up to educate students. It's become a holding tank. I'm here because I want to educate students. I want to share with them what I know. I want to increase their knowledge. I want to get them ready for college. I want them to learn something from me, just like I learn stuff from them all the time. And I cannot do that when people start taking away my livelihood. When they tell me I'm going to have a 12% pay cut and I can't pay my bills, that's going to make it very hard for me to do my job.
I don't like to go to school because I don't know how to read. I don't know how to do language. And I don't know how to spell that good yet. I don't like, you know. They say they gonna tutor me though. So they don't. And I don't want nobody to lie to me or anything. I just say I try to tutor myself. And I have many problems with school and at home and see you later.
Shit, well, speak up. Shit, I'm trying to hold that shit in.
I let it be known.
I let it be known.
That's all you right.
Yeah, what'd you say? Can we just all get home? That what it sound like you said?
Tell him, you just want to get along, yo. Fuck all that bullshit.
Hey, fuck that. I don't give a fuck about getting along. No fucking body. Five. I know fucking Rodney King is a motherfucking.
Can we get 10?
Yeah, he went out like a motherfucking sucker.
I'm that same 10.
Never did that shit. He went out like a motherfucking bitch. That's what he did.
You see that living color?
Yeah, Kevin is still alone. Come on, guys.
Come on, guys. In.
Take those clan hoods off and be a real American.
This whole tape is courtesy of Reginald. He's the one who taped the motherfucker getting his ass whooped down in the fucking Compton
deep East LA ass whoopings. He couldn't help the motherfucker, but he could tape him. What's up with that, Reginald? Nah, but you was close enough to tape the motherfucker, but you couldn't pull the niggas off of him. Why didn't you pull him off of him? He was a Mexican man. He wasn't a white boy. I can see Reginald Dent. But you didn't pull him off of me. All you did was tape it and got paid.
Hey,
why you get paid off a motherfucker?
Why did I get paid?
Why'd you get paid?
Because I taped history.
History? Why couldn't you pull him off of him? You know what I'm saying?
Hell no, I can't get involved in that.
Hey, but you a brother, I'm a brother, you a brother, I'm a brother, we a brother, I'm a brother, you a brother. I understand exactly what you're saying.
Because I can't get late.
Give me that.
His ass is already beaten.
There it is.
Good morning. Today, let me see. I'm supposed to start exercising. I'm exercising 2 years. So I think it's time to start. I'm getting out of shape. My energy's down, so I think I should do something about that. First of all, I need to get up out of this bed, and I feel so good.
Hi. I'm supposed to go to the city clerk's office. I'm one of the mayor candidates.
All right.
Hi. Yeah, I need to fill out. I'm running for mayor. It says, I request that my principal occupations, professions, and vocations be placed on the ballot as follows. I first wrote surgeon, but if I've got MD, pioneer, that might be a good word. Crusader's good. Warrior's good. But then they might think that I'm a gang member or something. Mm-hmm. Mother, MD. Radical feminist pioneer. Okay. I think those three might do it.
Radical feminist is a statement of position. So that would not be allowed.
Is non-misogynist one word?
I'd have to look that up. I don't know what it means. I'm showing my...
It means that I don't hate women.
Okay.
That'd be a good one.
Famous Hollywood Boulevard. There's usually something going on. Over the weekend, we've had half a dozen shootings in the last month. A lot of our tourists have walked the boulevard. When you get right down about Vine here, eastbound, things start to change dramatically.
We're here as professionals to help with our expertise.
Right there, just like we did last night. Just did this last night.
It's just been last 2 years we've been paired up, and we work community relations. And it's a good job. I enjoy it.
So you got shot in which leg? Did you get shot? Accident, car accident. Someone ran you over? Other gang?
And it's paid off really well in working our programs. Jan does the neighborhood watch, and I do the PACE program, which is basically ridding the city of graffiti, the abandoned buildings, trash debris, and
all the dope dealers collect.
Dope dealers and gang members congregate, and it's working out really well.
All the gang members that we meet out in the streets, we eventually get them on a... Let me get a good picture of one. Eventually get them on a flyer like this, information only, and it describes the gang member, what his placa or a gang name is, what gang he is, MS. Just now, we talked to several gentlemen that are already in our files, and what we do is we keep track of these gang members, because every month, it seems, they get arrested for something.
A lot of these gang members are in crutches, arms are bandaged.
It's
makes them easier to catch in a football season.
That's what happens in wars. You know, they're fighting every night, shooting each other. Sometimes we'll see a guy, two guys in a wheelchair. We'll see a guy in a cast, another guy in a sling, and head bandages. And, you know, that's macho.
Stay strong and bury our homie, just like we buried the rest, and go back and pray to God it don't happen again. And this way, cause we all gonna go. We got a million ways to die. We ain't got to go out like the homie went. Let's stop slipping. Let's stop playing around. Let's wake back up like we was before.
They call it the gang hangout. This the block. We grew up on this street here. We've been hanging out on this street here for about 15 years now. We was on the next street, you know, there's more riding in the middle of the block and stuff. And some of the fellas.
Say, Mate.
Hey, don't feel none of that shit, man. Hey, man, don't be feeling none of that shit,
Bone. CK Blood, that's enough. Tell these niggas, Bone.
Nah, what's up, man?
You headless, huh?
What?
Your shit done dropped down in your neck, huh?
Come on, cuz.
What are we doing, man?
Sherm head ass nigga.
Bone, what
sherm.
Are we?
Hey, nigga, don't be trying to say we sherm heads, nigga.
You a sherm head.
Watch out, cuz.
That's right.
You gonna be on the news. Get your ass out of here, Spikey, dog. So what? He on the news. Nigga, yeah. You gonna be on there too, punk.
Yeah, they don't see my face.
Hey, what you hide your face for? You got a warrant or something?
Yep.
Yeah, well, nigga, get up out of here then.
Yep.
These streets is my life, being out here, sitting out here, trying to make some dollars that I could never ask my family for. My grandmother used to give me money all the time. When I was in jail, she passed. So I got out here, not with the potential to get a job, I came back to the same environment. And in that environment, it was drugs. That was the kick in the thing. Smoking weed was too light for a person. Drinking wasn't. It was smoking crack over here because there's a lot of it down there. We ain't putting it down there. You'd be surprised. And, you know, and life was just, wasn't miserable for me, but it was at a standstill. I was misled. I had to go through a great deal of a fearful experience to get up out of there. I know that much. I was born and raised where Crips started in that neighborhood. And there probably been Bloods in that neighborhood where I grew up at, then I probably been a Blood. But it just that way, that's the way it goes. That's the way the ball rolls, like the street you're from. Them two little colors cause the major disturbance in people's lives that you pour bleach on, and they both neither have a color no more. Now what you fighting over?
And right here, where we at, 52nd and Main, is where my little brother got killed over them colors in a drive-by shooting. I also went to jail for taking the life of a human being.
What happened was, we argued, and the guy pulled a gun out on me. He said, don't move. And my reaction was, if I let him go, he gonna do something to me. So immediately, why he took so long, and I knew he didn't want to do something, I tussled with it. And the gun fell on the ground. And I picked it up and shot twice with it. And he fell to the ground, and I took off running, and I heard six more shots, ta, ta, ta. I don't know, but all the shots didn't kill him. Three shots was on the inning. One of them went straight through, you know? I mean, but they couldn't detect which kind it was. So we took a deal for 6 years on a manslaughter charge because of that, because I felt it was self-defense, though, and I should have been let loose. But in the state of California, law requires that if you have 1 minute to think about what you're finna do, then you don't have to really do it because you know the consequences.
I nearly died last when I had my last baby. Everything was painless, and I looked down, and the floor was blood. And I remember them telling me, me saying, don't cut me, don't cut me. Stop the bleeding, don't cut me. Because I knew if they cut me, my baby would die. It was too early. And they cut me open, and they took my baby, and I came to, and they said, your baby will die tonight. And I crawled to the ICU. And somebody saw me in the hallway and actually finally got me a wheelchair because I couldn't walk. And I went to her and I put my finger covered her whole back. And I put my finger and I pushed through and I touched her because I had to touch her. And I told her, you will live and you will win the Nobel Prize. I became a saber-toothed tiger, like a vicious queen, you know, like, fuck with me and you're dead, you know. That kind of mentality. was born in me, really, because I had to protect my child or she would have died.
Do you like men with beards or without beards?
People inside, how they are.
Yeah, see. That's got nothing to do with beards or
well,
no beards.
Well, your answer.
Her answer is good, very good. That's got nothing that doesn't answer your question.
Yeah. I trained as an obstetrician gynecologist. That's a doctor who delivers babies and takes care of women. During my training and while I was becoming a physician, practicing medicine, I found that most of what I had been trained had nothing to do with medicine or science. It had to do with making money and doing what everybody did before me. The standard operation was to do hysterectomies, to take out uteruses, to take out ovaries, to take out women's organs, to dispose of them, to get rid of them. And no one wanted to change that. So what I did surgically was create operations to save those organs.
Most Korean American parents, Korean American immigrants, work very hard and mostly for one purpose. Not for themselves, mostly, but they want to do so much for the children, for the next generation. My parents moved to the United States to live their American dream of providing a better opportunity, better education, and a better way of life for their children. My father worked a minimum of 3 jobs for a very long time, and my mother worked 2 jobs. They wanted to save up enough money so we can put a down payment on our house. I guess that is also part of the American dream. If you persevere in this country, you can achieve your wishes and desires.
Coyote Creek is where it was spotted. Now, Coyote Creek hits the San Gabriel River and joins the San Gabriel River just north of where the 605 and the 405 meet. Listen, they did find the body. They're over it right now, and it's definitely a body. I don't know exactly where. I just said it's underneath a helicopter.
Swollen river, and let's go upstairs to Chopper 2, who is in the, and Bob Turner, who's in the Lakewood area. That's down near Long Beach. Bob, what can you tell us?
Well, they've just recovered this dead body from the Coyote Creek, where it meets the San Gabriel River. A person was found dead in the river. The county fire department responded after a county sheriff's deputy saw what they believed to be a dead body in the water, and in fact, they have recovered one dead person. It believes to be, we believe to be a male. As we come in there, you can see these exclusive pictures. The county fire department checking over the body, and we don't know if this is a near drowning situation or if in fact a real drowning situation. These are the lifeguards and the firefighters from the swift water team that actually made the body recovery.
Treating him as though he's a dead body, and I guess somebody gets the idea. Let's check for a pulse. Well, it's not very often you get to see the last few seconds of somebody's life.
I was having a nightmare. I remember when I used to ride on buildings. Some dude threw the ball at the back of my head, and then he pulled out the gun. You know, he pulled the trigger, and no bullet didn't come out. And then the second time he pulled the trigger, bullet went in my finger right here. And then I was like, dang, I got shot. What can I do? What can I do? And it was a bad nightmare. And, you know, that dream made me get a good thing through my head. And, you know, everything was all right since then. See you later. Oh, you wanna watch TV with me? I'm about to eat breakfast in a little while. I'm about to watch Fetch Your Gadget. Da 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 da.
This is the Sunday paper, October 4th, 1992, with my story here about the 44 officers who were listed on the Christopher Commission and the fact that the LAPD has done very little to clean these officers up, despite the fact that the commission found all kinds of problems with them. Now, since this story broke, the my phone at work has just been going like crazy. The a lot of cops calling up anonymously, many of them just sort of chewing me out, cussing me out, venting their anger and frustration. Number one, that we would do the story. Two, that we would list all these 44 officers and alleging, or the, making the contention that their careers are ruined now that we publicly named them.
An officer of the Los Angeles Police Department, you were number 33 on the bad cop list. The list was published by the Los Angeles Times.
Yes.
What are your thoughts here as you...
My thoughts, number one, I hope everybody can see through the media as far as the LA Times.
It just enrages me when some of these guys, as they did, insist that they were misquoted or that their comments were taken out of context. And, you know, I mean, I think if they really had, were serious about their complaints and gripes, they should bring them to me or my editor. It just makes the whole thing messy, and I just don't like it.
This is my little side job. Gotta make money some way. No money right now to be made in television or film. So basically, you know, I take side jobs, doing construction and anything else that's available.
I gave Paramount Studios my resume probably two different times. 6 months ago, maybe 6 months before that, they send you a letter saying, yeah, we have your resume on file, and if any positions become open, we'll get in contact with you, which is bullshit, because the fact is, you have to know somebody to work here at Paramount Studios. I have a dream about maybe working for some big major studios or whatever. But that's just to start off with, because I want to do my own thing.
I'm taping a wedding tomorrow. I know it's not a movie or anything, but you know I got to get paid. I got to pay my rent. So I tape weddings, birthday parties, things like that. Anything on videotape, I'll do.
Basically what I'm doing is explaining how the wedding will be shot. So I made this little math thing. And
first grade drawing.
But it works. And we're trying to decide from which angle will we get the best results, because we only have two cameras. There's a lot going on with a lot of people.
Check it out. Roll out the barrel. Now, that ain't crazy. And they really having fun, too. Check them out.
This is for Richard's bachelor party.
Hey!
I thought we would sail over to Isthmus Cove, to Harbor, spend the night, and then go around and sail over to Santa Barbara Rock, which is out here, and do some big boy sailing. He's coming up.
Hey.
Wow.
Cool.
And that thing's, it's still alive. I think that's a skate is what it is.
I thought it was a,
Well, it looks like a stingray, but you know, it's kind of flat and,
You know what's sad is this. When I talk to young black people, they no longer see Martin Luther King as a leader of the cause.
Right.
a person that I think is absolutely fantastic, what they see is, as a leader of their cause, is a person like Malcolm X, who advocated...
A militant.
Yeah, who
a
advocated violent overthrow of government.
Right. Mm-hmm. These are the things that I disrespect most about blacks, are the lack of entrepreneurship, okay, of being able to break away from the crowd and doing something individually on your own, which is, you know, that's how I built my business. That's obviously how you built
yeah,
your
but
business.
You know what, Steve?
Your
dad
wasn't
doing
it. There are
black entrepreneurs. There are a lot of black entrepreneurs.
There are.
Too.
There are lots of them. But I mean, I think the Asian community typifies that type of
entrepreneur. Let me ask
you.
You know,
I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that when Asians come here from other countries, that has been their dream for a lifetime.
Yeah.
To come here and make it big, and they get low interest loans to start companies where blacks
I keep
yeah,
hearing
I,
that.
Whoa, stop, guys.
Okay,
let's not even argue this, because that's not even worth arguing.
You know what?
Because I can't start a business. I'm not talking about people like you, Richard.
I'm talking about people
who come from...
This is fantastic.
Other
I love
areas.
It. You know what?
It's not true. There's Vietnamese people that come. It's not true. They just work their butts off, okay? That's it.
Happiness, here we come.
That's Wendy, Rachel. That's my wife. Smile, Wendy. Hey, now.
Who I'm doing?
Tennessee ice tea.
You mean you are not romantic, you're not nice or nothing.
Close the door. Let me rub your back when
you make
say
me
so.
Tired. You make me tired.
Come let's make this day to a crowd of them. Girl, it's me and you now.
We're on a cable car going up the top of Queenstown. Yes, we really are here, and we are gonna take some great pictures.
His brother Albert Kim was murdered. I first heard the news in New Zealand. Albert had come to me and told me that there's this friend of his who, whose parents own a gun shop, and he had asked Albert to see if he can help him out on a part-time basis. I told him I didn't see anything wrong with it. The sheriff detectives told me that this particular gun shop was involved in manufacturing and selling of illegal weapons. The owner's son thought Elber was leaking information, or Elber had found out about what was happening, what was going on inside the store. One day, they told Albert that they were going to go target shooting out in the desert. When they got there, they shot Albert, my younger brother, they shot him 8 times. Killed him instantly.
Some kind of problem. Looks like a business dispute of some type. Mm-hmm.
It's a new gang, Rebeldes 13.
And that's Rebels.
Rebels.
They hang out 14. With TMC. Mm-hmm. They're both together.
They're
friends.
Oh, they're friends. Oh, is that
nice?
They have some friends. Huh? So and the graffiti that you see here, it's from the Rebels. Here, the manager here is very intimidated because of the young kids that are going in there and just filling with graffiti.
Well, tell her when she calls communication, she's afraid. And yes. She can be contacted by phone, because sometimes the officers will get here and they can't find anything and they'll leave.
Right.
And she's watching the suspects and she wonders why they don't do anything. So
Right. Communications
will call her back and say, hey, we can't find them. We're the suspects now.
Okay.
And she can direct them by phone.
Okay. You want to come and meet her?
We're going to walk through the building. We'll just park and
come on through, okay?
Watch yourself out going up here, Jen. Is that locked up there?
Pardon me?
Is that locked up there?
I don't think so. But you can just push it out.
Okay, let's go on up. Yeah, it looks like they've been partying up here.
Having a party every night here.
Uh-huh. Everywhere you see up here on this roof, it's graffitied. The Rebels and TMC are hanging out together. They generally do when they get a lot of pressure from the police department and the neighborhoods. If you give us some information, you say you got access to a camera and you're able to help us with pictures of some of these guys, we'll just...
Oh, yeah.
So they don't know...
When I mentioned Flipper, she knew who he was.
Yeah, well...
Well,
we need the...
Because she probably knows most of them, the top
five. We need the top five guys. You give us that information and we'll get rid of them for you.
Taggers like to graffiti on buses. Y'all get together, some of your friends, y'all go to the bus stop, one of them get on the bus, the other one jump on the back of the bus, write his hood and their business code number, Like, when I used to tag, I used to have a code number 277. I already been to the police station one time for riding on the bus. I got caught on gauge in Vermont riding on RTDs.
Nigga, I'm bigger than you, so what you wanna do? Didn't know we had a 22. Straight sitting behind his back. I grabbed his pockets and then I heard six caps. I fell to the ground with blood on my hands. I didn't understand how a nigga so young could bust a cap. I used to be the same way back. I guess that's what I get for trying to jack the little homies for they grip.
Me like many things, I'm what I see. From the street, I come up when I come to be. They don't get no you're gonna do when you grow up and have to face responsibility.
I'm right here standing next to my friend Emilio. Goofy 1, it died on August the 5th in front of Goofy 2 house on Hardell in 59 Place. This cross is for rest in peace Goofy, and you see his dad put it right here. And I'll make it more shiny. We thought that was firecrackers. And then after the car took off, we see Goofy drop it down to the floor where you see the flowers at. And then we was like, fuck, what to do? I was like, on my brain, my mind was telling me what to do. This never happened to me before. I'm shocked. Somebody just got shot in my face. I don't know what the fuck is going on, though. Goofy telling me to help him, and I'm like, damn, I don't know what to do, man. What you want me to do? Fuck that color paper there, man, I ain't touching him. You know, I cannot touch no dead body. And now since I fainted when we went to go see him, I want to see him again, though I can't, because he's gone, and he's 6 feet deep, and, you know, I want him to be on top of 6 feet deep.
This is kind of weird, but I have something wrong with my mouth. I got something growing in my mouth, like a wart or a... Let's see if maybe you can see it. I'm going to go to the doctor up here and have to take a look at it. I really, really hate this. I hate doctors. I hate medicine. I hate having things on my tongue. I hate it.
I had those two ulcers in my eyeballs, where my eyeballs cracked, popped, but that was from stress, and maybe this tongue thing is some kind of stress deal too, I don't know.
Is it coming off?
No, they don't come right off.
But it seems kind of weird to have busting eyeballs and warts on your tongue, high blood pressure, and maybe next I'll have seven toes and hair in my ears or something.